Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank thee for thy servant Alexander Crummell, whom thou didst call to preach the gospel to those who are far off and to those who are near. Raise up, we beseech thee, in this and every land, evangelists and heralds of thy kingdom, that thy church may proclaim the unsearchable riches of our Savior Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A reading from the book of Ecclesiasticus. If the great Lord is willing, he will be filled with the spirit of understanding. He will pour forth words of wisdom of his own and give thanks to the Lord in prayer. The Lord will direct his counsel and knowledge as he meditates on his mysteries. He will show the wisdom of what he has learned and will glory in the law of the Lord's covenant. Many will praise his understanding. It will never be blotted out. His memory will not disappear, and his name will live through all generations. Nations will speak of his wisdom, and the congregation will proclaim his praise. If he lives long, he will leave a name greater than 1,000, and if he goes to rest, it is enough for him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The psalm appointed for today is a portion of Psalm 19, verses 7 through 11. Psalm 19, verses 7 through 11, which we'll recite together in unison. The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey in the comb. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. Glory be to thee, O Lord. Again, Jesus began to teach beside the sea. Such a very large crowd gathered around him that he got into a boat on the sea and sat there while the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land. He began to teach them many things in parables, and in his teaching he said to them, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed,
Some seed fell on the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Other seed fell on rocky ground where it did not have much soil, and it sprang up quickly since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. Other seed fell into good soil and brought forth grain, growing up and increasing and yielding 30, 60, and 100-fold. And he said, let anyone with ears to hear listen. When he was alone, those who were around him, along with the 12, asked him about the parables. And he said to them, to you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything comes in parables, in order that they indeed may look but not perceive, and may indeed listen but not understand, so that they may not turn again and be forgiven. And he said to them, do you not understand this parable? Then how will you understand all the parables? The sower sows the word. These are the ones in the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on rocky ground. When they hear the word, they immediately receive it with joy. But they have no root and endure for only a while. Then when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. And others are those sown among the thorns. These are the ones who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth and the desire for other things come in and choke the word, and it yields nothing. And these are the ones sown on the good soil. They hear the word and accept it and bear fruit, 30, 60, and 100-fold. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to thee, O Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today, we celebrate the feast of Alexander Crummell. He's not a household name, but perhaps he should be. He was born on March 3rd in 1819 in New York City and struggled against racism all his life. As a young man, he was driven out of an academy in New Hampshire, dismissed as a candidate for holy orders in New York, and rejected for admittance to the General Theological Seminary, my seminary, when he applied there. Ordained in 1844 as a priest of the Diocese of Massachusetts, he left for England after being excluded from participating in diocesan convention. He had already turned down the possibility of being ordained here in Philadelphia when Bishop Onderdonk of Pennsylvania at the time told him that no black priest would be allowed to have admission to diocesan convention, and nor would any black parish be allowed to do so. Crummell then went on to Liberia, which he hoped would be a place where the church and where black people and all people could flourish. But he was disappointed there when things did not go according to plan, and Liberia turned out not, in fact, to be a utopia for anyone, including for black people. So then he came back, and his ministry in this nation and throughout the Episcopal Church spent more than a half a century and three continents. Everywhere at all times, he labored to prepare his people and to build institutions that would serve them and provide scope for the exercises of their gifts and leadership and creativity. His faith in God, his perseverance in spite of repeated discouragement, his perceptions that the church transcended the racism and limited vision of its rulers, and unfailing belief in the goodness and greatness of black people are the legacy of this great pioneer of the church. In 1887, in a paper called The Race Problem in America, Alexander Crummell wrote this. He wrote, the American people say to themselves, we will do the thinking, philosophizing, the scientific work of the nation, but you Negroes must work. This is your destiny, and that will be your gain and advantage. 1887, Crummell wrote that. He was asking, I think, why people would take it for granted in the late 19th century that simply demanding that black people should work and work and work, while other people do the important business of the nation, should ever accrue to their gain or advantage. 135 years later, It's a bit perverse that we have to ask the same questions, especially in light of the work that Crummell did. He was a prolific worker, a prolific proponent of the gospel, and an effective one, too, over an Alexander Crummell in the church today. When he went to Liberia, I suppose he was looking for utopia. And he was disappointed to find that Liberia was no utopia. The United States is no utopia, is it? Certainly not for black people. But it's not utopia for white people. It's not utopia for Christians. It's not meant to be. It cannot be. There is no such thing as utopia. Even the kingdom of God is not utopia. It's not meant to be a utopia. The kingdom of God is meant to begin to take over our lives in this world, even as it leads us through a vision of hope to whatever Christ is leading us beyond the fulfillment of all things in all time. But the kingdom of God is meant to be becoming established, even in our own midst, without borders, without kings, without princes, without secular rulers, to do its bidding or its work. Simply governed by the power of the Holy Spirit, able to transcend borders, limits, barriers, and races. The kingdom of God is no utopia. It is a hope and a way of being human and living into holiness that God calls us to. When we live into holiness in the kingdom of God, we won't be racist. We won't look at one another with the kind of disdain that Crummell knew that black people were looked at, with which black people were looked at in his day and in ours. The kingdom of God is known not by its borders, not by its rulers, but by its effect, by the effects of justice, peace, mercy, forgiveness, kindness, and love. Those are the borders of the kingdom of God. Those are the signs that we're entering the kingdom of God, when justice, peace, mercy, forgiveness, kindness, and love begin to hold sway in our lives, then we can begin to say that we're entering the kingdom of God. How far we have to go, however, how far we have to go and how slow we've been traveling. We need to look to people like Alexander Crummell to encourage us on our way, not to give up, to know that what he was fighting for in the 1880s, the 1890s, at the turn of the 19th century to the 20th century, has not stopped to be important for us, to be fighting and working for when we're well into the 20th century now. In fact, if anything, Crummell's great example sheds an unfortunate light on the slow work that we're able to do in our day and age when everything else advances with such tremendous rapidity. But justice, peace, mercy, kindness, forgiveness, love, the boundaries of the kingdom of God advance at a distressingly slow rate of speed. Not because of Alexander Crummell. He's urging us on, even now, to pick up the pace, to remember his own life, work, and ministry, to take it up as our own, and to see that the kingdom of God beckons us if only we will help to do our part in establishing its boundaries of justice, peace, mercy, forgiveness, kindness, and love. May Alexander Crummell pray for us and work for us in heaven, even as we pray and take up his work on earth. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world. Almighty and ever-living God, who in thy holy word hast taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Daniel, our bishop, and Nora, Stephen, Nicholas, and Gordon, my priest brothers and sisters, who worship and work in this place and parish, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, especially Donald, our president, the members of the Congress and the courts, Tom, our governor, and Jim, our mayor, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy body. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who are sick with the coronavirus, doctors, nurses, medical workers, and essential workers of various occupations who put themselves at risk for the well-being of others. All those who are unemployed and are worried about their livelihoods, their families, their careers, and their well-being. All those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, who suffer because of justice that's been denied and who struggle for that justice, and who work to bring about an end to the sin of racism in our hearts and in our society, and so help to usher in the kingdom of God. And all those in this parish community or beloved of this community who are sick or in need of any kind, especially remembering to pray for Chris, George, Sue, Tom, Kent, John, George, John, Tim, Homer, Mary Jane, Marlene, Mark, Richard, Suzanne, Will, Kathy, Paul, Sarah, Lee, Jan, Jean, T.R., Armand, Bill, Janet, Mike, Julie, Larry, Susan, Tucker, and all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, especially all those who died from the coronavirus in the past day, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, of Blessed Mark the Evangelist, and of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, Judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those with heart and repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit.
walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Of your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Of your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Pray, brothers and sisters, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord receive this sacrifice at my hands, to the praise and glory of his name, both for our good and for that of all his holy church. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is his meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty everlasting God, who in the obedience of thy saints has given us an example of righteousness and in their eternal joy a glorious pledge of the hope of our calling. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Christ. After supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sins of the world, grant us thy peace. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood. may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him that taketh away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Body of Christ and bread. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food and the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporated in the mystical body of thy Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom we God which passeth all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.